We just taught the world's strongest chess AI how to learn from its mistakes, and the improvement is one of the biggest on record. We put together some really cool ideas to teach this bot how to learn on the fly. So without further ado, welcome to episode 4 of Making Stockfish Stronger. So, how does the strongest chess engine in the world think? Basically, you have two parts. A neural network evaluation function that estimates how good a position is, and a search algorithm that tries out different moves and then uses that neural network on the positions you end up with. If you rinse and repeat 100 million times per second, out pops a superhuman chess bot. These evaluation functions have been getting better and better lately, to the point that someone recently trained the first ever grandmaster level position evaluation. I'd know because it was me. But Stockfish uses a different approach with a much smaller neural network. Stockfish is really strong because that neural network is both smart and fast, but the one thing it can't do is learn while it searches through a position. When top chess players plan ahead, they bring in not only what they know from previous games, but also what they learn about the peculiarities of that position. If a grandmaster underestimates a position while they're planning ahead, and then they see a similar position, they know to be more careful. Computers today don't come close to that level of adaptability. Until now. People have actually tried this learning on the fly thing. I talk about some of the old techniques, but none of them really work anymore. When evaluation functions were just simple formulas, they weren't all that hard to beat. But Stockfish's neural network is so hyper-optimized that it's impossible to hand-design something stronger than it. But the thing is, you don't have to replace it. You can just improve it. When Stockfish plans ahead, it sees a lot of positions with similar structures. And even the smartest AI models will make similar mistakes in similar positions. If they miss a tactic like a fork or a check in one position, it stands to reason that they'll miss it in another. So the idea is, if your evaluation is always off, don't ignore it. Correct it. If the neural network keeps overestimating the value of, say, a bishop in a corner, then collect all the positions with a bishop in a corner, find out how much the neural network overestimates those positions, and then decrease the evaluations based on that amount. If it keeps underestimating a set of positions, then just adjust it the other way. And if the neural network is always spot on, then keep its predictions. That way you get the benefit of both the evaluation function's intelligence and the ability to learn from your mistakes. But there's a big problem. If you want to know how close your evaluation function is to the true value of a position, you need to actually know that true value. And that's not something we have access to. In fact, it's our end goal. All you can get from a chess engine is a decent approximation of how good a position is by looking ahead a few moves. Better than your neural network's initial prediction, but still not perfect. But if you're smart about things, that's really all you need. To improve, you don't need a perfect teacher. You just need a good teacher. In fact, chess engines like AlphaZero and Leela Chess Zero improve by learning from stronger, but still not perfect versions of themselves. And with chess engines, you're constantly taking a position, using your evaluation to estimate how good it is, and then searching through future moves to refine that estimate. So to calculate the error, all you have to do is take the difference between your accurate search value and your less accurate predicted value. I've put up a more in-depth explanation, but the gist is, let your neural network do its thing and only update it based on its observed error. So our next big challenge was, how do we define what makes positions similar? Our solution was to split possible positions into buckets based on aspects they share, like where the bishops are. You can have a lot of buckets with a few positions, which means your correction history is looking at really specific properties. Or you can have a few buckets, each of which has a lot of positions, which means you'll have good data efficiency. You can group together positions based on how the board changed recently or what the board is like right now. But the bottom line is, you have to choose, and no choice will be able to do everything you want it to. Stockfish actually used to have a simple correction history based on the positions of all the pawns, and it kind of struck a perfect balance because it was specific enough to detect clear biases in Stockfish's neural network, but not so specific that you ran into data efficiency problems. But there's a lot of stuff about chess that's not captured in the pawn structure. I mean, what's a game of chess without a queen or a rook, even if most of us do end up paying them at some point? The idea is, instead of having just one correction history, to have multiple correction histories operating in parallel. So instead of having a single history looking at how one type of position, like positions with a certain pawn structure, correlates with bad evaluations, you have multiple correction histories aggregating information from different angles of your position, like how many pieces there are, the positions of different types of pieces, and anything else you want. You can take anything you want into account. So suddenly everyone's trying out different combinations of correction histories, adding them, removing them, modifying them, expanding them, contracting them. But after the dust settled, we ended up with 5. The first 4 grouped together positions based on where certain pieces were located. We had 1 for the positions of the pawns, 1 for the bishops and knights, 1 for the positions of each player's pieces, and there was also 1 that was added later, based on the opponent's last move. And when we tested it on our testing framework, the results were literally off the charts. We measure improvement in terms of ELO, and with top engines you're lucky to get 1 or 2 ELO points. This test showed us 8.5 ELO, which is well above the 99th percentile in terms of improvements, but things did not stop there. Whenever we integrate some new system into Stockfish, we're always looking for potential connections we can make to other parts of the engine. And these correction histories were a really good example of that, because the average error of the evaluation function is a signal of something else. If the correction histories tell us to expect the neural network to be off by a lot, then that's a sign the position might be complicated and take some extra time to figure out. So not only are we able to adjust the neural network's prediction, but there's also an opportunity to let the search algorithm know to slow down and take a closer look at the position. The idea isn't complexity, it's Corrplexity. Using complexity information to guide search has actually been done before. A Go engine called CataGo recently introduced a feature where the neural network itself predicts how uncertain its output is, and then the program puts more time into those uncertain positions. I helped adapt this idea to another big chess engine called Leela, and it gave around 5 ELO points, but this is the first time something like this has been done for Stockfish. The first implementation of Corrplexity for Stockfish actually came from another chess engine, Alexandria. It modifies the late move reduction, which is where you do a reduced search on a move you think will be bad, and only do a full search if it's promising. Alexandria's author made it so that if the magnitude of the correction is large, you look at potential future moves for a bit longer before discarding them, and it gained a good bit of ELO when we ported it to Stockfish. Now, if you've watched this series before, you'll know that it isn't about Stockfish getting stronger. It's about me making Stockfish stronger. And at this point, I hadn't contributed much other than a couple ideas. So I was like, I gotta get in on this. So I looked through the entire search code for places where Corrplexity could be useful, and I found one thing. A lot of the time, Stockfish finds an obviously winning position in the search tree, and if the evaluation function is super confident, then Stockfish will just say, this position is winning, and move on. The code is literally just, if the neural network's evaluation, which is now corrected, is at least some margin higher than some bound, then we stop. This is called futility pruning, and it's really good at making sure Stockfish only spends time on the most important positions. But if the evaluation function is confident and wrong, then that's a big problem, because it may trigger a false positive and cause the search to miss something important. Even after the initial evaluation is corrected with these extra terms, we still don't want to get ahead of ourselves. One of the things I've come to appreciate about Stockfish development is that getting an ELO gainer requires both a good idea and a good way to implement it. The most successful Stockfish developers usually follow some version of the strategy, come up with an idea, and try out as many variations of it as you can, both because it casts a wide net and because it's convenient to stay in one section of the code. In the case of futility pruning, I had a vague idea that I wanted to make futility pruning harder if the correction is large. To start out with, we added the correction to the value used in futility pruning because it was part of the evaluation, which gave us a linear effect. And I started experimenting with this graph. Because a very positive or very negative correction means the position is uncertain, I first tried to subtract half of the correction value's magnitude from the original linear graph, but that didn't work. Then I realized that this decreased the rate of futility pruning, which is a bad idea because the rate of futility pruning had already been heavily optimized through tuning. So I tried to compensate by adding a baseline value to move the futility pruning rate back up. Finally, I decided to try something even more aggressive, where we cancel out the effect of positive corrections completely, but double the effect of negative corrections, and then add a bit back to compensate for the reduced futility pruning rate. I submitted it to the testing framework and we got a pretty nice performance boost out of it. That was my 7th improvement to the world's strongest chess engine. Thank you to all my Patreons and YouTube members for making this video possible, and as always, if you want to contribute to Stockfish, I've put a link to the Discord in the description. Goodbye!